Life Pentecostal Holiness Church, and just am grateful for the worship that's been happening, sensing the presence of the Lord and the love of God's people. I am Doug Bartlett. When I was here last time, I was your missions director, your conference missions director, and recently, a few weeks ago, I was elected as the conference superintendent, but we're in transition in positioning someone to take my place. And by the way, tonight at the Global Outreach Service, we will be announcing our new, we used to say, and we'll still use that title, Evangelism and Missions Director, but we will call this position the Great Commission Ministries Director. I'm sensing that the Lord wants our conference to embrace the identity of the Great Commission. And that's going to require that we have Great Commission churches. I think I'm in a Great Commission church right now. And most of our churches, unfortunately, are not. But God bless you for what he's doing here. And tonight, by the way, I will preach a little bit. I say a little bit. I don't know how much time I'm going to have because we have so much going on this evening. We will be celebrating the Global Outreach Offering as we typically do. I'm going to be introducing again the new executive that's going to step into my place that I was serving in previously. We're going to be honoring our outgoing bishop, Bishop Danny Nelson and his wife Rose. And then they may give me a few minutes to say some things. But I will be talking to you about being empowered for the Great Commission. There are some basic essentials that must be in place in a church if we're going to move forward in being a Great Commission church and a Great Commission conference. That's where I sense the Lord wants to take me tonight. But before I show you a little video, I want to show you a video in just a minute that's a kind of a recap of what your giving did in 2022. I just want to remind you of something. God is still up to something. You know, it's so easy to get your eyes on what the devil's doing. And the activity of the enemy is getting more and more intense every day. But you know, the Lord earlier this year stirred in my spirit from the Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 17. Just that verse there where you know, Jesus is in a setting where he's done a miracle there by the pool of Bethesda. And he's being confronted by the enemy. And yet in the midst of that, he lets them know that my Father is always working. And I am working. Right in the middle of some hostility there against the work of the Lord, Jesus says, my Father is at work. I want to let you know that he's still at work. And I think there's evidence of that of what's happening in this church. And that has kind of been my theme this year as I was processing through being the missions director, that God is still up to something. Thank you, Goshen New Life Church, for your giving in the year 2022. I got to get these on. I didn't write the fonts. But $16,475 that you gave to IPHC World Missions. And thank you, Sister Dean King, for your work as the local missions director. And we're going to be giving away another King Award tonight to a lay person in our conference in honor of Moses and Dean King. But thank you for the work you do here to promote world missions. And I'm happy to report to you that your giving, and this video that you'll see in a minute will show that as well. But in the year 2022, where the devil is doing all he can to keep people from coming to Christ, through IPHC World Missions, we planted 922 churches. And we moved our influence into five new countries. In the last 5 years, we have planted 3,719 churches. That's what your giving is doing. We could talk a lot about other things and the way that it's doing. But this video will kind of wrap it up. The Lord bless you. It's good to be with you today. Okay. One more thing. How many of you knew that Jesus is Pentecostal holiness? Hey, he is. We're doing his work.
Amen. Thank you, Bishop Bartlett. At this time, I'm a firm believer that missionaries do not have to go overseas to be missionaries. And one of the missionaries that we're welcoming now is a newer ministry to our denomination. Also, let me say this very quickly. Our missionaries and our denomination have to raise their own support to go overseas. So you'll see some of them have these cards and these magnets for you to put on your refrigerator or wherever you put your magnets to help remember them in prayer, but also every gift you give financially per month above your tithe goes to supporting them. So when you give to the missions department, they have to raise our own funds separately. So that's one of the reasons we want you to eat with them, hear from them, and see if the Lord leads you to support one of those missionaries. So Pastor Arena did not bring his materials, but we will have that available for you. We'll get together and get some. Will you be in the Holy City tonight? You better say yes. No pressure. No. We'll get it from you. We'll get your stuff. So you can partner with them in prayer, if nothing else. But I want you to welcome Pastor Arenas. He tells you about one of the newer ministries of the IPHC, please.
Thank you so much. By chance, did you all get the video to work? You want to go ahead and just play the video real fast for me? My name is Michael Arena, and I'm a director of Magnolia Hope, which is a residential program for Falcon Children's Home that's focused on children recover from sex trafficking. Currently in the U.S., it's estimated that over 300,000 to 400,000 children enter into sex trafficking situations each year, and that's in the U.S. alone.
Magnolia Hope is an outreach of Falcon Children's Home and is a residential program aimed at restorative care for girls aged 11 to 18 coming out of sex trafficking.
With estimates of 300,000 to 400,000 child victims in the U.S. alone each year, this is a very big, big issue with only in the U.S. 200 beds focused on helping them in the restorative plan.
We will be the only licensed home in the entire state of North Carolina. And what that means is not only can we take girls that are coming from private homes, so in the custody of their parents, but also girls that are coming from the child welfare system. Instead of them going to foster homes that haven't necessarily received the specialized training that these girls need, they can come to our program and receive the treatment that they need for their specific trauma.
Many people ask, how do these kids get in these situations? A lot of these kids are wooed by older men. They're groomed in social media. One of the myths we hear is that we believe that this kind of situation happens only in third world countries or anywhere else other than America. But the truth of the matter is that it's actually found in our communities, in our backyards, where we're just oblivious to it because we're unaware of it.
Our desire at Magnolia Hope is to operate as a greenhouse of sorts, where we can bring these girls in from the harsh environment and offer them a safe and nurturing home.
The truth of the matter is that there's a lot of funding that goes to the recovery of the children, but very few dollars are actually spent on the restorative care.
We're located in an undisclosed location in Eastern North Carolina, where the girls receive trauma-informed therapies, on-site schooling, life skills classes, gardening classes, and so much more.
These kids need our help, and it's going to take our entire communities to come together to fight for them. again, introduce myself. My name is Michael Arena. I'm the director of Magnolia Hope. We are the newest ministry of Falcon Children's Home. As you know, Falcon Children's Home has expanded in very various ways that Brother Joey Leggett has just seen the vision heart of God to have, a residential home, but also a mothers and babies program, to have a maternity home. And then now we have this home for sex trafficking victims. We are the only licensed facility, as we said in the video, in North Carolina, and we are able to serve up to six girls at a time. Our program is about a one-year program, depending on how committed the girls are in their restorative care in their program. So you're looking at 1 to 2 years in the program. But they're going to get schooling from Falcon Christian Academy. Many people don't know that. That's another vision that Mr. Leggett had, is to have a private school that offers schooling on campus at Falcon, but also to the community. So our girls are enrolled online. They receive various therapies like equine therapy, art therapy, garden therapy. We do group discussions. We get them substance abuse counseling and different other counseling and therapies that they need. So a lot of people don't realize that trafficking victims, the complexity of their trauma is so different than most traumas. And it is onion layer after onion layer after onion layer. And sometimes it takes years for all of those layers to get peeled back. But one thing I want you to know, and here's me preaching, okay? Jesus restores all. And his eyes are on those girls. And there is no doubt in my mind that each girl that encounters Jesus will not only just get some healing, they will get full restoration and wholeness. Because Jesus didn't come to get us partially cleaned up and healed. He came to bring wholeness to the broken. So I know that Jesus is doing an incredible work. And I actually want to tell you about a quick story about a young lady whose trauma was complex. I mean, we're talking FBI's involved. We're talking cartels are involved. We're talking very, very sophisticated operations in our own state, North Carolina. This young lady was deathly scared to go to a church. One, because of the shame that she had. But the other side of it was because she had some stuff going on with her family that involved a church. Anyway, so she wouldn't go to church with us. She was, I didn't want anything to do with Jesus and anything like that. And over time, we just started seeing some of these onion layers get peeled back, and we get to the heart of some of the issues that she had. And here's the reason I'm telling this story. Many girls that come into these situations to us, they have zero idea that they were even being trafficked. This particular young lady, she's actually reading a book that's in the program. It's a required reading. And in it, it's a survivor of sex trafficking. She's got a beautiful ministry now. Her name is Rebecca Bender. There we go. And they're reading this book. And I remember we were on an outing with our girls to a peach orchard to go pick peaches, right? And they got out, most of the girls, to go use the restroom because it was a long drive. And it was me, my little daughter, and this particular young lady. And I remember her gasping in the back of the car. And I'm like, oh, Lord, brace for impact. I don't know what's about to happen. And she said, Mr. Michael, did you know that I was trafficked? And I was like, yeah. Really? No, I'm playing dumb now. Like, really? Oh, wow. You know, it's like this aha moment. And she said, in the book, she says that trafficking victims dress like this, act like this, talk like this. They live like this. It fits me to a T. I had no clue that I was being trafficked. Did you know that this guy that I thought was my boyfriend and loved me was actually trafficking me? He's called a Romeo. Did you know that, Mr. Michael? And I'm like, wow. You know, like I'm playing dumb. Wow, you know. These girls have no clue that a lot of this stuff is happening. Some of them, they come from a familial background of trafficking. Mom was in the life. Dad was a pimp. Granddad was a pimp. This is all I know. All I know how to make money and survive is doing this. So let me go fast forward a little bit to this story with this young lady. She ended up running away from us for a few months, going back into the life. She was recovered. She came back into our program. And through the weeks, I started just kind of ministering deeper and deeper ways to this young lady, speaking more life. See, a lot of times, you got to play that balance because you don't want to bombard them. Because it starts, let me back up a little bit. We know that love heals, right? These girls, for the most part, have never even received true, genuine love. So when they get encounters with love, that's scary. When they come from chaotic life into peaceful rest,
That's not good. That's fish out of water to them. They push it away because, one, they don't think they deserve it. They don't think that they can receive it and that they're not deserving of that love. So this young lady was in that same kind of predicament. And one night she told me, she said, "Mr. Michael, last night I had demons manifesting in my room. They were squeezing my throat. They were killing me. I was going to die. I knew I was going to die. And all I remember was that your mom came to me two nights before, and she said, if you ever find yourself in a situation you can't get yourself out of, just call in the name of Jesus." So she said, "I started calling on the name of Jesus, Mr. Michael. I kept calling, and it started getting tighter around my throat. I could feel the fingers." And she said, "All of a sudden, I said, Jesus, save me." And she said, it was just like, the whole room went into peace. And she got to sleep. So the next night, we are sitting at the dinner table, and another young lady made a little jab at her heart, and she gets upset. She goes upstairs in our house. And so I felt the Lord say, "Go talk to her." So as I'm talking to her, I start hearing the Holy Spirit just give me insight and revelation to her heart. And as I would press in to say something the Holy Spirit would me say, she would blow up. "Don't say anything to me. I don't want to hear it, Mr. Michael. I don't care. This is what I deserve. I don't care. I mean, just blowing up. And as I started realizing, she had a demon manifesting. And I started saying, like, "Who is this talking right now?" And she said, "This is Ben. He sits right here on my shoulder. And he tells me when I need to run and when I need to survive and when I need to go. And he's telling me not to listen to you." And I said, "Well, I don't like Ben." She said, "Ben doesn't like you very much." I said, "Well, I don't like Ben very much either." I said, "Ben's going home tonight." Ben said, "He's not going home tonight." I said, "Well, Ben doesn't have a choice." Because Colossians 2:15 says that the enemy has completely been disarmed. Yes, all authority has been stripped away from them. Yes. Jesus took it all. He didn't leave a little bit for him. Right. So the Great Commission is for us knowing that the gates of hell will not prevail. So when we shine the light in this dark world, it doesn't get darker. It has to run and flee. It gets lighter. Yes. So when the people of God start shining the light of Christ, only breakthrough, deliverance, and freedom come. So as I'm talking to this young lady, she keeps blowing up as the Lord gives me insight. And she had a little bananagrams. I don't know if you're familiar with that game. It's kind of like Scrabble. And she starts, the demon starts going, "Hey, well, maybe Jesus will talk to me in these little things." I said, "Well, it ain't work like that." But Jesus does want to talk to you. She said, "I'm too far gone for Jesus to save me." And the Holy Spirit said, she says that because she believes that she made the choice to come into the life. And I said that to her, and she starts blowing up. And I told her, I said, "Sweetheart, the trauma you endured before you even got to this life is what led you there. You had no other place but to there. Go there." So then I said that. She blows up, and the Lord says, "Stop talking. Go hug her." And I said, whoa, Lord. Got to give boundaries. I don't want to violate those boundaries. And I'm a guy, and she's been violated by various men, lots of men. And he said, "It's okay. Go hug her." I said, "Okay, Lord, I'm going to trust you. I'm walking faith right here." I come up to her. I'm hugging her. I just got my arms wrapped around her. And she's got her hands and her face like this. And she's just kind of rocking back and forth. And I said, "Sweetheart, it's okay." And I said, "Just hug me." Because I knew the Lord said when she hugs you, breakthrough was coming in. And so I'm rocking her. I said, "Hey, it's okay." She said, "I don't like you. I don't love you. I don't care about you. Leave me alone. Get out of here." And the demon's just manifesting, just talking all sorts of nonsense. And I said, "That's okay. You don't need to love me. You don't need to care about me. You don't need to do anything for me or to me. I just love you. I care about you. I'm here for you." And as I started praying that, she started feeling these fingers around her throat again that she felt the night before. She said, "Mr. Michael, I feel it again. They're trying to kill me again." So I laid my hand on her back, and I just kept rocking her. And I was just praying in the spirit. Praying in the spirit. She couldn't hear me, but the demon could. And he said, "Shut up. Don't you talk. Blah, blah, blah." And I said, "You're leaving tonight." And all of a sudden, I got hit with the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm talking the love of the Father like I've never felt in my life, like cool water running over my entire being. And as soon as I felt it, I knew it went into her. And all of a sudden, her hands just dropped. "I'm so sorry. I love you." And there was freedom there. See, when we are of Christ, when we have the love of Christ, it breaks all strongholds. It brings deliverance to the broken. So when we stand in the gap for these young ladies, or when you stand in the gap for the people in your life, in your community, in your school, your workplace, you bring freedom. So as you said, I'm going to quickly wrap up. My wife on the video said we're like a greenhouse of sorts. That was actually the name that we wanted to go with, but we were getting pushback, like, are y'all like a gardening club? Like, no. So we went with Magnolia Hope. Magnolia represents dignity, royalty. It represents purity. And this is what's been stripped away from these young ladies. And our goal at Magnolia Hope is to restore that to them so that they know that Jesus loves them. They are valuable, and they are way more than what their body can offer. We're Hope, Magnolia Hope. We want to give these girls an understanding that they have a hope for a future. They're not going to live in prison to the chains that their captors have put them in. So we're a greenhouse of sorts. We take them out of the harsh environments, put them in a controlled environment where the sun can shine bright. And so, see how that preaches? This preaches good, right? Can shine bright, bring healing so that then they can't go back into the elements, back where they were coming from or in a different place. So when you give to Magnolia Hope, you're not keeping a ministry afloat. You're not just paying payroll. You're not doing other things. When you give to Magnolia Hope, you're giving a young lady a hope into her future where she had no hope. So I thank you guys for your time. I thank you for letting me share. And I hope that you are blessed by this.
So stand right here just a second. Yes. So if we decide we want to partner with Magnolia Hope, with in prayer, also, how can we give monthly financially?
You can go to Falcon Children's Home's website.
Okay.
There's two ways to give online, or you can write a check, and we only take, you know, checks for $1 million. So if you got it.
Okay, go.
No, you can just, when you write to Falcon Children's Home in a check, just make sure you notate in the memo that it's for Magnolia Hope. Or if you give online, choose us in the drop-down bar. We would love to again, monthly partnerships or one-time giving, anything goes a long ways. Right now we have our first home. I should have said this earlier. We have our first home. It's at an undisclosed location in North Carolina. We have our second house that we're working on getting it licensed. Again, like the video said, there's about 300 to 400,000 children in the U.S. alone that come into the life.
Yes.
Each year, there's only about 200, probably now 220 beds total in the whole country that's designated in helping them in the restorative care. Mm-hmm. Programs like Magnolia Hope. So we need to multiply our homes, and financially giving gives us the ability to do that.
All right. Thank you so much, Pastor Michael. I'm going to take that microphone from you. Another one of our local missionaries, a home, one of our own, is Pastor Tom and Lisa Miles. Y'all welcome them as they come and tell you about their mission work.
Tom and my wife Lisa. Most of you know us as we come here to church. We are with Enlighten World Ministries. Most of you know Enlighten. We've had a food ministry here for the last 13 years. My late wife and I started Enlighten World Ministries mainly to feed the poor and homeless here in our communities. And we've been doing that up until just recently when God has directed us, Lisa and I. Pam died 2.5 years ago. And since Lisa and I have gotten married, God has directed us to kind of change our path into more of a disaster recovery, disaster assistance mission. And that's kind of where we have gone now. Most of you know that we've just gotten back from a mission in Florida, and you're going to see some pictures from our mission there and some other missions from our trips in Louisiana and New York. We are also mission or project leaders for Adventures and Missions. Adventures and Missions is a missions organization which launches project leaders like Lisa and I into the mission field, and we lead mission teams. And in Florida, I was a construction manager, and Lisa was the base ops manager or leader. Where mostly she did the cooking, right? And as construction manager, I just made sure that the teams went out, they got started on building the homes or working on the homes. And, you know, we did everything from electrical work to drywall and flooring. And we were able to get six houses where people could move back into their homes in the month we were there. So that area of Florida, Fort Myers, was damaged during Hurricane Ian. And they had 386 homes, I think it was, that were completely inhabitable. And the city actually wanted to condemn those homes. And through Adventures and Missions and our works, we were able to convince the city that we can rebuild and get those people back into their homes. And that's exactly where we're at right now.
As Tom said, we were able to go together, and obviously this was very special. As most of you know, or a lot of you know, we were married in April, and that in itself is a tremendous God story. And it was just great to be able to minister as a couple. I that first week, I got to go with Tom and assess him a little bit and got to learn and meet the people, which was so important. But then, you know, feeding the teams that came in, it scared me to death. I have four kids. Tom has five. Together, we have nine. And 15 grandkids, but I had never cooked for more 20 folks, and it was just 55 people a day for 10 days, but it was a lot of fun. You see our team by there. We got so close to these young people. They're so phenomenal. The sacrifices they make and made are just tremendous. And did you want to share the scripture first before I go into this? Okay.
So you know, a lot of people ask us, why do we do this? Why do we go out and serve our local communities? And it's the same reason why all these missionaries do this. You know, we go out and we serve God where he is, where he's working. Scripture says in Romans 10, 13 through 15, it says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are not sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news." So we go out and meet God where he is, and we disciple those that don't know him and otherwise would not have heard the good news of Jesus Christ.
One of the things that we got to do every morning was to meet with the staff when we were with the AIM team, the ROC Recovery Operations Center there in Fort Myers. And we had these cultural values that they had already established when we got there. Tom was replacing, for the weeks that we were there, Chris and Sarah Horvath, who are a couple that sold everything back in the fall of 2022. Bought a camper. They have four children under the age of 10, three girls and a little boy. And we were just giving them respite so they could go do and be and go see their family up in Minnesota. But when we were together, we had, and Tom will tell you, because this, I grew up, I am, and I have to be so careful. I'm a bulldozer sometimes when it comes to things. I just get so task-oriented. I got that Martha thing going. It's the Mary thing that I have to keep, oh gosh, relationship. And one of the things that we've talked about every morning, we're going to pursue the pace of peace. It's not about getting everything done. There are 386 homes down there devastated from September 28th, 2022. 206 have said to AIM, "Yes, please help us," because flood insurance down there, you want to take a guess? Somebody, just throw out a guess what you think it is annually in that part of Florida. How much?
$2,200.
Good try. Not even close.
$98,000.
$16,000 a year. Flood insurance. Can you imagine that? And these are people for generations have lived in these homes. So that pace of peace is important, and just learning that everything is going to get done in God's timing. Relationships are greater than the task. Remember those greater than, less than things that you had to do in math? The relationships were greater than the task. When these teams, a lot of times they come with a skilled person, a guy, a girl that's mastered in cabinetry, electrical, and all of that. I'm trying to go fast because I know we don't have a lot of time. But they come in, and when the homeowners come in, because it is a part, you know, we want the homeowners to come in and get to see, and if they can help and be a part of that, we stop everything. Everybody stops what they're doing. They go meet them. They talk with them, want to know how their week's going. Some of them live miles away with family or friends. So relationships were always greater than the task. There are no mistakes. People down there, look, I don't know anything about hanging drywall. I can hammer a nail, and I can use a screwdriver and a drill. And, you know, and I learned a lot of things just in that first week I was following along with Tom. But instead of mistakes, they call them learning loops with debrief or feedback, because it's important. Because these are volunteers that are coming and giving their time. And there are a few people that really, really know what they're doing. And these kids or the other young adults or other people they've brought with them, they don't necessarily know what they're doing construction-wise. But, man, they have so much fun learning. And oh, all the young people we got to work with, just in our hearts forever. We do uncomfortable. And I'm sure all of these ladies and gentlemen right over here that have just shared with you, yes, if you're called to missions, if you're called to Jesus, if you're called to be a Christian, you better be called to do the uncomfortable.
That was uncomfortable right there. Now, we were in Fort Myers, and this is an attic that me and my partner Eddie was in for 2 days. We were laying on our stomach in an attic where the roof was not insulated, and we were running electric in that attic for 2 days, 96 degrees outside, and it was pretty bad.
And then we have a need is not a calling. Oh, my goodness. I don't know if you struggle with this, but sometimes the tyranny of the urgent can just take over. You're like, oh, my gosh, I've got this fire. I've got this fire. This person needs this. Needs. They get, can you imagine, calls all the time. All the time about, I heard you're helping my neighbor with their cabinets. I heard. And having that spirit of discernment and just knowing, yes, Lord, we are working here. This is what you've given us to do. We've got to be task-oriented, relationship-oriented. But, Lord God, please give us discernment and help us to prioritize the needs so that our calling is lived out with integrity and in a way that will bless as many people as possible. And then the last thing and the most important thing, and we sit it every day and high-fived each other, God's got it. God's got it. We cannot do this in our own strength. By Christmas, they're hoping all people in these 386 homes will have a kitchen, a bathroom, their running water, and they can have a functional home, may not be where they want it to be yet, but that they can celebrate Christmas. Will you pray with us for these 386 families? Y'all, most of these people are in their 80s and their 90s. Many of them, the younger ones were in their 70s, okay? And so anyway, God's got it, okay?
So, you know, between Lisa and I, we've been in missions. Like I started missions 13 years ago, and Lisa started missions even longer ago than that. We've been all over the world together, you know, well, separately, but, you know, Lisa's been to Africa and South America. I've been to Cuba, Puerto Rico, doing disaster missions. I think this Florida trip was my 22nd trip. Not all of them were disaster recovery, disaster assistance trips, but we've been doing this a long time. And then all of the local missions that Enlighten has done over the years, and you know, serving food every second and fourth Saturday here in the local communities. So where are we going from here? Well, October, if God sets all logistics up for us, we'll be in Bangladesh. We're going to be joining the IPHC missions director, Vijay, in Bangladesh. And Enlighten the World has funded a well for them to put a well in the southern province so that the school and the church there will have a well for that community. And we want to go and build a well house for them and help them build that the church and school there for a few weeks. And just be in prayer for that God gives us the logistics and sets all that up so that we'll be there in October for at least a few weeks.
And that well, as we've been able to share with some of our closest friends and family, is dedicated in Pam's name. Tom's wife, that some of you don't know. So it is there for her and those school children when they drink water. Well, and so we're excited to be a part of that. When I was a little girl, I grew up Southern Baptist, but all my great friends know that I am Baptist. And but we finished, as that? Okay. When I was little, this was a song that we sang in GAs and ACT Teens, Girls in Action, ACT Teens, where it's a mission. So I just want to close with that. And we're finished. Is that right? Okay. All right. Is there anywhere I can go for you? Is there anywhere I can go for the places you have been for me? Is there anywhere I can go? I'm willing to be used, dear Lord, whatever the price may be. So if there's anywhere we can go for you, just make it known to me. So where has God asked you to go?
Amen. I'll remind you that it is your responsibility to sit with a missionary today at the meal. That is one of the purposes of you coming and us eating together. And we're so thankful for Pastor Tom and Lisa and their ministry. And y'all know how to get up with them easier than you do with those other missionaries that are here today to find out how you can help support and partner with them. If you'll welcome Pastor Danny and Judith Williams as they come, please.
I failed to talk to the sound man back there, but we're going to do this one at a time. We'll just tell you when the slide comes up. Thank you, sir. And so we are Danny and Judith Williams. We serve in Nepal and India. And we started out in India and several years ago. In fact, I've been going back and forth to India for 23 years. Judith and I have been married now for 14, and so we've been going back and forth since that time. And we started out in many ways, but God led us into this way. We'll show you. That is the Everest region. You've heard of Mount Everest in the Himalayan mountains. That is between Nepal, is between China and India. And so we're not far from the Tibetan region. And so God has done that. We believe that the fivefold ministry is the keys to discipling the nation and bringing people to Christ. Next slide, please. This is us, and then this is Ashok Lama. You saw him in the earlier video with that Pastor Doug gave us, and Bishop Doug, excuse me. And he is our new assistant national director to me. And he followed me around and now for 6 years and translated for me and heard all of what we were doing and what we wanted to do. And so you'll hear about that in just a minute. And we just thank God that this man of God and his family is part of our leadership. Next slide. This is a Buddhist temple. This is actually in the city of Kathmandu. Have you heard of that city before? And there's many of them there, but this is the largest Buddhist temple. And we just are in the midst of a Hindu and Buddhist nation, as well as Hindu in India. But God has brought us very far because now we are a legal IPHC church organization in the nation of India and recently Nepal. Amen. Next slide. Next one. India Ministries, we started out in India, as you heard. I've traveled all over the nation of India. Judy's traveled with me all over that nation. We started with two churches in Mumbai, which is old Bombay, Maharashtra state. And now we have, and I need to keep forgetting to update this, we have about 65 churches now in western part of India that are part of the IPHC. And we're actually expanding north and different and south and different places in the whole western section of India. That's Tony Mesquita and his lovely wife Roma, and we have to update that picture because he has two children now. And so this man of God, I've known him since he was a child, and going back and forth to India, and he was in my Bible school when we started that many, many years ago, and he is a great man of God. He is a powerful preacher. As well as he is taken our credit card, and he has never taken one penny from us. And all of these years, he is a man of integrity. And next slide. And this is where Judy comes in.
Wow, what I've heard this morning from every speaker is passion. And that's what I hope you hear from me, because we are passionate about what God has called us to do, and ever so grateful. At one time, I was a mission director in a small IPHC church on the East Coast. And when the people-to-people child sponsorship program first began, I thought to myself, what a wonderful thing that would be to be able to do that one day. But, you know, the enemy comes in and says, you'll never be able to do that. But how many know God? With God, all things are possible. And I'm so grateful that I've been privileged to start the first child sponsorship program in Nepal. We currently have 35 children. I just was able to get the last four sponsored this past Wednesday night. To God be the glory. Next slide, please. I am also in charge of taking care of the funds for relief. I want you to know that when you give funds through IPHC, that we are the feet on the ground and we have integrity and we use every penny wisely. We pray. We do not just throw that money out there. We pray and ask the Holy Spirit to guide us where all of it should go. So rest assured, it is handled properly. Next slide, please. Women's ministry, another thing that is very close to my heart, children and women's ministry. We live in a country, as Danny said, Hindu-Buddhist country, where women are very marginalized. They are not encouraged to be ministers, but we currently have 65 IPHC women ministers in Nepal. Thank the Lord for that. We pour into these women. We cannot possibly reach all of the people we desire to reach, but we can pour into the leaders. That is our heart, our passion, our mandate from the Lord is to pour into the women leaders, Danny and the men leaders, and let them go out and minister and reach those that they can reach so much better than we ever could. And I thank the Lord for the ones that have come from America, taken their vacations. They have come and they've ministered along beside me to reach these women, to pour into these women and to bless these women. Pray for them. Pray for them. They deal with things that we cannot even imagine there in their culture, things that come against them in the darkness of the Hindu and Buddhist culture. Next slide, please. Also, we have construction teams, medical teams, ministry teams. I'm in charge of the logistics of these teams, which I thought was going to kill the planner in me when I first got there to Nepal. I also am a Martha, and I like everything planned and organized. But I've had to learn over the years to go with the flow, to stay in peace. I love what you shared, sister. I can relate to every bit of that. And God has changed me. How many know he changes us when we go and when we do what God has called us to do? But I do thank him for every privilege, every opportunity, every dollar, every prayer that has kept us on the field and helped us to overcome many obstacles. And we plan to continue to do what God has called us to do to the nations as long as he allows. God bless you.
Go ahead. We have the ministry teams that have come, because I believe in the fivefold. We've had prophets. We've had different ones. You see, Pastor Ryan Jackson from the Capitol Church in Garner was with us last November, did an absolute marvelous job teaching and bringing that, and I helped him, he came with me. One church asked us to do a deliverance service. They don't always do that, but we came to that thing, and he came with us, and he saw many manifestations of demons, but God, how many know God's more powerful than those things? Always, 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 he gives us the authority, and he gives us the love of God for the people that need to be set free. Next slide. Many more. We have done so many. This is just a small representation. We don't have time nor the hours that I show you all of the meetings. You wonder, after Judy talked about all that she did, you wonder what I do. Well, And she does more than she says because she does all the administration. I travel, and we have pastor meetings all over the nation. And we've done this in India. We've done this now in Nepal. From all seven provinces, we have been able to establish pastoral networks, and we have other networks that we are part of, and we just thank God. But they're becoming part of us, those that are Pentecostal. And so we bring all ministries together that we can, come from the United States or wherever, to go and help minister and bring different flavors. When I was a pastor years ago, for 29 years of my life, now 23 years in missions, I brought all kinds of people in to have a flavor for the congregation, to have a different understanding, from the apostolic to the prophetic, pastor, evangelist, and teacher, etc. So we just thank God we've been able to do that. Next slide. We also are actively licensing ministers. We are also adding existing churches that are independent. God spoke to me back in India about establishing a network and bringing things together. But when I got to Nepal, because of circumstances where we were blocked out of India to be able to live, when I got there, God said, go out and extend an invitation for family, to bring pastors into a family. And that's what we've been doing. And that's why you're going to see what God has done with that. Next slide. This is Ashok Lama. He is aware of a national meeting, our only national meeting that we had 2 years ago, 3 years ago now. And next slide. And we had 150 pastors were supposed to come. We had a $5,000 budget. And next slide, please. And 500 pastors showed up. And overnight, we had a $12,000 budget. Now, you have to understand, we pay for the pastors to come in. We pay for them to go home. And we lodge them also, and anybody that we have to overnight. And we feed them the whole time. Because these are poor pastors in villages that are, you know, have small congregations, some of them larger, but they are very poor people. And so we're training them to help bless the people by teaching the people to tithe and to give. Because they're always looking for someone to give a handout, and I've always told the pastors, God is going to support you right where you are. If you will just reach out. Because when they start giving, they'll start being blessed. I've watched this for 23 years overseas, how God has blessed so many. We did a lot of licensing there. We're going to do a lot in December. Next slide. That's shoes, if you can't tell what it is. When you come into Asia, you come into a church, you take your shoes off. Because it's been a very dirty society out in the public. And so when you even go into a home, you normally take your shoes off. 500 pair of shoes there. And brother, your scripture this morning was the beautiful feet. Yes, these are the people that are leading their people to Jesus. We've seen, and we'll go into a lot of stats, we've seen thousands of people come to the Lord through these churches. I mean thousands. And we just thank God for what he's doing. Next slide. When we went to Nepal, we literally had six churches. 6 years ago, as of June, we now have 750 international Pentecostal holiness churches. Amen. That represents 35,000 members. God is giving us influence, and he will increase that because God spoke to me the number 15,000. So we just see what God wants to do. You see, I don't have that capability. I'll just tell you. I don't have capability to lead a nation, but God equips you to do what you need to do. I remember starting out like now Melody's doing, just starting out. Don't have a lot of stats, don't have a lot, you know, a lot of things. I remember that. I remember coming to this church years ago and didn't have a lot. But I tell you what, you just trust God, yes, and he will do it. So we just thank you for what you have done in this church. That is the 500 pastors, by the way. we had seats in that whole place, and we set them up, looked really good, and had so many people come in, we had to take out the seats, and everybody had to sit on the floor. And it was amazing. And so we thank God. Next slide, and this is the end, where in 2 years ago, God spoke to me, and now it's time to raise funds for a national headquarters. Now, you know what 2 years ago represented in COVID and everything else. And Judy did say, are you sure God spoke to you? Because, you know, your reputation's on the line. I learned a long time ago. I don't have a reputation. God's got it. And if I look foolish, it's okay. You know, it's just okay. Because I have made mistakes over the years doing cross-cultural ministry. This is our new headquarters, $400,000 headquarters that is now bought and paid for. Next slide. And that's a different aspect of it. There's about 5 bedrooms in there, a very modern kitchen. And we have places on top terrace for more training and different things there. This is a great blessing. For 5 years, people would say, where is your headquarters? And I say it was my living room table, because that's exactly where they came to meet me for years and years and years. You'd serve tea and cookies and or a meal, and that's where we would meet. But this is God's blessing. It's God's timing.
Okay. Our time's almost up, but we were privileged in April, March and April, to go and get this decorated. So we have decorated the house. Thank the Lord for Hobby Lobby and all the good Christian things at Hobby Lobby. There are no Christian things that you can purchase in that country. And so the house is decorated with scripture all throughout every room. God bless you and thank you for your attention.
And in December, we have a dedication of our facilities there. And so we just thank God for what he's doing. So pray for us. We thank you in this church for what you've done. Pastor Ken, thank you so much. God bless you.
Amen. Thank you so much. They have refrigerator magnets and support cards. They'll be on the tables next door, and you're going to sit with them anyway, so you can talk to them about putting these magnets on your refrigerator to partner with them in prayer and also in giving. Pastor Melanie, she comes. The pastor talked too long this morning, so it's 12 o'clock, but this is a Pentecostal Holiness Church. So they're used to running yet 1202, 1203, a little up. No. We're gonna let Pastor Melanie give you, she gets the same amount of time as everybody else, and then we're going to eat together, okay? So give your undivided attention to her this morning. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pastor. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. My name is Melanie Ross, and I'm excited to share with you what God has put on my heart and the passion he's given me. I have been called to Kenya, Africa to serve and love on those with disabilities, also known as differently abled. I have been to Kenya, and I just want to tell you a few things about it. If you'll go to the next slide, please. I am currently a special education teacher in Craven County Schools, and this is my 15th year. I'll start in August. And every day is a new experience. I absolutely love it. The children pour into my heart, and I learn more about them. Just to kind of give you some stories, up here in the top corner, you have Miss Agnes. She is in Kenya, Africa, with Down syndrome. I have the next little girl with glasses is Macy. The next one that I'll point out to you is this little girl right here that's given the peace sign. That is Zanala. She is with Jesus. In October, she passed away, and she got to wake up the next morning in the arms of Jesus. Amen. This year has been very hard. I've had 3 students pass away. But I'm thankful for the opportunity that every time they were in my classroom, kind of like Miss Judith said about Hobby Lobby, Jesus is talked about in my classroom. And if you know anything about the public schools, you're not supposed to. But the reputation, I'm going to speak about my God. And so those 3 precious souls have impacted my life, and that's what I want to do in Kenya, Africa. And so the Lord's called me to go outside of my comfort zone. If you to look on this screen, what is the thing that is the most common? And I am a school teacher, so you can talk back. Smiles, that's right. But the even more most common is that God loves each and every one of them, and he created each of them for a purpose. And we've read in Psalms 139 that we are all fearfully and wonderfully made, and I believe that is true for everybody in the world. If you'll go to the next slide, please. The ministry that I will be doing in Kenya is just to remind everyone that they have a purpose in life. In Kenya in 2017, I was able to travel there, and I met a young girl in Karen, Kenya, who'd been raised by monkeys. You see, she had a disability, and so her parents thought, well, you must be demon-possessed. We don't want anything to do with you, so they threw her out. I have a picture of her on my table outside if you'd like to take a look at how precious she is. But it made me understand that the calling that I have on my life is not just meant for Craven County. It's meant for something larger. And so I want to be used by God, and I want to go over there and with the Holy Spirit chip away at that big rock of that these children and adults with disabilities are demon-possessed, because I do not agree with that 100%. I'm excited to be under the leadership of Ron and Sharon Wooten while I'm there, and I'll be hopefully starting what's called a ministry like Sidekicks. Again, in the Holy City, each summer we have a program and a summer camp for those with disabilities. We kind of call it Sidekicks. And so that's where a child with disabilities or an adult comes in, and they're buddied with somebody who's typically developing. And I saw on one of your slides earlier today, it said Goshen New Life is a family. And that's what I want to help happen in Nairobi, Kenya, is that when people walk into the church with or without a disability, they know they are home and they are loved. And so that's exactly what I want to do. The program has been started in Nione, but would you happen to know that the people that started it have moved to Dubai? So the foundation that's already been set is what I want to go in and keep going with. I think about the story of Mephibosheth in 2 Samuel. You see, Mephibosheth was being carried by his nanny, and in an instant, she dropped him from running, and he developed a disability. And King David sent forth for him, but he was kind of given this response from the servant of, are you sure you want someone like that? Meaning his outward appearance, because he was crippled from the legs down. You want someone like that in the presence of a king? And King David said, yes, I want him. I want him to come. And I feel like King David would have looked at Mephibosheth and said, I understand how the world sees you by your outward appearance, but I want to tell you what God sees inside of you. And that's exactly what I want to do in Kenya, is remind the people of those with disabilities that God has a purpose for them. If you'll go to the next slide for me. You see, some of us have been called to be sent, and some have been called to be senders. Not sinners, but senders. And I want to let you know that I have been called to be sent outside of my comfort zone, the thing I've been doing for 14 years. I'm literally packing up and moving to Kenya. I want to go where Mephibosheth went to a town called Lodabar, and he was looked at very wrongly. And I want to go where people might think that they are residents of Lodabar, but remind them that they are children of the king. And so I am excited to let you know that I am 60% raised, which is amazing. I'm excited for that. I talked to World Missions 2 days ago, and they are ready to send me, but I'm lacking some funding. And so if you will pray about that, will you pray that you will support one of these ministries, that you will pour in it, and know that they are not our ministries. They are God's ministries. We're just being willing vessels to be the hands and feet of Jesus somewhere else besides our hometown. So I'm excited. If you'll go to one more slide, I do have a monthly newsletter, and right now it's all about itinerating and what that means and what it looks like for a single person to do this and to go into missions. If you'll take out your phone and your camera, you can scan that, or you can sign up on the paper. But I want to thank you for being mission-minded. I heard a quote earlier this week that said, when you sacrifice, you're not really you're trusting God when you sacrifice. So know that you're trusting in God, and you're pouring into a mission, and you're pouring into a ministry to allow us to be the hands and feet and being partners with us. Thank you so much for this opportunity and for allowing us missionaries to come and speak to you today.
She also has a picture and information magnet and her support card today. Don't forget to sit with a missionary, talk to them, and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you what you can do to help support them in prayer and financial support, because they have to raise all their own funds to go overseas. As we get the information from Pastor Michael Arena, we'll make sure that that is available to you. Don't forget, tonight starts the what do we call it, Bishop? The Great Commission.
Global Outreach Service.
Okay, all right. You said something about Great Commission earlier, too. changing the name. Okay, I should have checked with the boss. I should have texted her during service. Okay. And that starts at what time, Bishop? 5:45. So make sure that you, if you get lost, just look for the lights of the city. Yes, sir. Please come take the microphone.
We will also have a reception following the service to honor Bishop Danny and Miss Rose.
Yes, sir. Okay. All right, so in just a moment, we're going to say the blessing. Typically at Goshen, the young people go eat first in line, but today that's going to be different. We're going to honor our Pastor Aaron. I want you to stay with us, please. We're going to let you go in the front. We're going to let our missionaries and their guests and families go. Then we're going to let the adults go. And then young people, you just have to be last today. But normally that you're first, but the first shall be last and the last shall be first. So we're going to honor those that are here today with that. So let's say the blessing. If you're not sure where the groceries are, just follow the line of people, okay? Follow us on social media and in your worship brochure. Pay attention to what's going on. We'll see you tonight in the holy city. Sit with a missionary and pray about what God wants you to do. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for food and for family and for missions and missionaries. We speak blessings upon them and their families and the ministry you've laid on their hearts, God. Be with them, guide them, and show them, and go with them, protect them, give them grace and mercy and support and joy for the journey. And we'll be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Shake hands with two or three people on your way next door. You're dismissed.